Good evening to all of you. On behalf of National Institute of Advanced Studies, it gives me great pleasure to welcome all of you to this evening public lecture as a part of the Silver Jubilee celebrations of NIAS. And it's my privilege to introduce Dr. Anil Kakodkar, who is the speaker for the evening, and you will appreciate later why it is very special for me in particular. Frankly, Kakodkar doesn't need an introduction because I think he has occupied a lot of newspaper space during the last few years for various reasons. But still, just to make it complete, he is one of the very well-known nuclear technologists of this country. And to some extent, you can also say he is one of the nuclear technologies made in India totally. He was born in 1943, a little younger to me, and had his early education in Madhya Pradesh and subsequently moved to Mumbai, where he did his engineering degree, and joined the Atomic Energy Establishment Training School, Trombay Training School, when I had an opportunity to be in the same batch, the seventh batch of the BRC Training School, Atomic Energy Establishment Training School at that time. And I joined the physics division and they joined the mechanical engineering stream. So in a way I can say that I have seen him growing as much as he has seen me growing in different directions. His first major contribution and achievement in BRC was the Dhruva reactor. You may recall that that was the first reactor designed and constructed in India without any collaborations, and fairly powerful 100 megawatt reactor, though it is not a power reactor. 100 megawatt is not a small capacity, and I still remember when I was taking some visitor in BRC, usually the reactor is not open to visitors from abroad. So he was just driving past and he looked at it, what is this? He said, it's a Indian, it's a reactor, 100 megawatts. So who supplied it? I said, no, it's designed and built by us. It's not supplied by anybody. He just, ha. Said, you mean no collaborations? I said, no collaborations. He was a fairly well experienced nuclear technologist and he could understand what it means. Okay, and he made some few other comments which I will not say here. And then subsequently we were closer working together during the early years of the 1974 peaceful nuclear explosion. And he is considered as one of the key players in the entire program associated with this. He has also been a major architect or one of the architects of the pressurized heavy water reactor program, on which our entire energy program depends on. And a certain amount of credit must be given to Dr. Kakodkar for making that program stand on its own, in spite of several other problems which we are all familiar with. And he took it next to the next level, the advanced pressurized heavy water reactor, advanced heavy water reactor, that is a thorium reactor, which everybody recognizes as the future direction for India to take, which will change the scenario in a very big manner, and perhaps for the whole world also. So he has been consistently at the cutting edge, working at the cutting edge, and he has contributed. Because he occupied important positions in the DAE system as Director Bark, Chairman AEC, and after retirement, everybody expected that he will occupy some chair where he will continue what he was doing. No. Now he has turned out to be a major advocate of solar energy. And some people may think that, okay, he is becoming part of the bandwagon. Everybody talks about solar today. So Kakodkar is also talking about solar. Just to ensure that you don't go back with that impression, he doesn't talk about solar because solar is fashionable, but because he thinks the kind of technology inputs which the nuclear program has got, if only the same kind of technological inputs get into the solar sector will be in a very different place. And today's his one-point agenda is to bring in high technology into the solar sector in the way in which we have done it in the nuclear sector. When you will agree with me, that has not happened in the past, and that probably is one of the reasons why we are nowhere in the competitive edge in the solar energy sector. He has been well recognized. He is Padma Vibhushan. He's a member of the scientific academies like Indian Academy of Science here, or the Indian Academy of Engineers, or the National Academy of Sciences. He was the president of the Indian Academy of Engineers for a couple of years also in the past, and he's enjoying life now. So Dr. Kakodkar, I am very happy that you have accepted an invitation and be with us today and give this lecture on the development of solar energy in India. Please.
Thank you, Dr. Amurthy. Well, let me first express my gratitude to Dr. Amurthy and NIAS for this opportunity. It's always nice to be here. I have come here several times and spoken, and I actually enjoy being here. So thank you for this opportunity. Let me begin with a some kind of an anecdote. It was in sometime in late 80s or early 90s that the NTPC people at that time, they came to BARC and said that they were angling some World Bank funding for solar energy, and said that let's design a solar thermal plant to be dovetailed into a thermal power station. And the idea was that you put in that extra energy, then even during the peak of summer, when the heat sink temperature is high, you will still get the full power because you pump in that much extra solar energy into the system. And to try that, then so then I asked him, then that looks fine, but then why BARC? So he said, no, I think you can network all the competencies that are involved. You can do the engineering here. TIFR can look at the optics and the design of the heliostat arrays and things like that. ECIL can look at the controls. And of course, NTPC is there to sort of integrate all that engineering. And so we actually worked for a 20 megawatt solar thermal plant even in those days. And the only mistake I did was I somehow felt that being a non-conventional energy system, I must seek funding from the Ministry of Non-Conventional Energy at that time. And within DAE, in fact, I was told, everybody told me that, no, you just, we create a fund here and support it ourselves, And I somehow felt, no, that will be stepping on somebody else's toes, so we'll not do it. And I think that was a mistake. Anyway, that project went nowhere. And then I was giving a lecture in Staff College in Hyderabad. And our old boss, N.B. Prasad, was there. And I, of course, talked on nuclear energy. And he said, no, he didn't know what I had done earlier. So he said, you must work on solar energy. And with my background, I defended, saying that, no, that has to be done by another ministry. There is an allocation of business, and we should restrict ourselves to nuclear. And then, of course, he said, no, but you can always say solar power is nuclear, because energy from sun is nuclear. And so after that, I lost, sort of eliminated all my inhibition, and now, because when I got into solar, there were news items saying that that's a conspiracy being played in against the solar energy, that here is a nuclear fellow who has been brought in, as if, brought in to destroy solar energy. So, but I truly believe that India's future, that's what I'll spend some initial few minutes to. If you look at it in a time frame of maybe 40, 50 years from now, and I have said this right here in this hall earlier, India has, I think, at the scale at which it will require energy, nowhere to go except to take recourse to nuclear and solar. And I have firm conviction on that. And so it's necessary that we put equal emphasis on both these fronts. And so it was in that context that when this opportunity came for me to be kind of working for solar energy, I felt that this is a godsend opportunity, so I just grabbed it. What I'm going to do in this presentation is essentially to kind of run through some of the ideas which I have in terms of taking them up for implementation in the short time frame, and also towards then I'll talk about some of the things that we need to do in the long term. Necessarily, these are all very preliminary things, not fully matured. As we move along, there may be a need to change course because things may change. So this will be kind of as I see it now, kind of thing. And towards the end, of course, I'll do touch about again linking the solar energy and nuclear energy for addressing the larger energy problem at which one could expect at that point of time. Now, we all know, there is always often a debate: how much energy do we need? And I keep repeating this. I must have projected this, not exactly this, but this kind of picture maybe 100 times by now. But I still do this because I think it's very important to recognize the quantum, how much energy we need. And if one wants a human development index for our country, which is comparable to a respectable human development index, we must reach up to that knee of that curve, because that's the minimum threshold of energy where one would get close to the high human development index, which most of the well, some countries are already there, and most of the countries are aiming at, and we can't afford to be left behind. And so the minimum per capita electricity that we should aim at is, according to me, 5,000 kilowatt hour per capita. There are debates, people think this is too large a number, why do we need so much of energy, India is a warm country, we don't have heating requirement, and so on and so forth. But this is a global statistics, all kinds of countries are there, not necessarily countries in the cold regions. And we know that in summertime, the air conditioning load, in fact, leads to huge power demand. So it's not as if you require energy only when it is very cool. You also require energy when it is very warm. There are also philosophical issues. People think that should we not, we are a country of Mahatma Gandhi, so do we need to do that? But I think we are living in an interdependent world. The aspirations are dependent on what's happening elsewhere. And so a large system that India is, I want to very strongly emphasize this point, that we must target a number, something of this kind, 5,000 kilowatt hour per capita. So in energy terms, I call that as India of my dream. Now, this is not easy. Taking into account the margin between where we are today and 5,000 kilowatt hour per capita, and also take into account our rising population, which may stabilize, 1.6 billion, 1.8 billion, somewhere there. And which in turn means that we need to add energy into our system, which is an order of magnitude larger, 10 times larger. Just to appreciate this scale, the additional energy that you would need, and I'm talking about only electricity, for this purpose of this lecture, energy, please treat it as synonymous with electricity. But even on that, the additional electricity that you need to add in the Indian system will correspond to roughly 40% of the total electricity produced in the world. So these are some mind-boggling numbers. And of course, of late we get into the somewhat depressed mood whether India will any time go there and all, but I think we should not lose our heart and indeed aim for such a thing. A look at energy resources in that context would tell that, first of all, if you're talking about addition equivalent of 40% of present day electricity produced worldwide, then you're talking about huge energy demand. And 40, 50 years from now, that kind of energy may be very difficult to access. What you see on this table is a picture today for the world. I also put China there because that's another country which is actually guzzling energy, and India. And at today's rate of consumption or production of energy, certainly it looks as if it will last 100 years. But to translate that into the galloping increase in energy demand, this 100 years would shrink, and shrink very fast. It may shrink to something like roughly half, 40 years, 50 years. And surely this country would have a serious crisis at hand in energy terms 40 years from now, if we don't do something about it today, in the context of accessing a sustainable energy source. you can look at the same thing a different way. Instead of looking at it at today's rate of consumption of energy, look at the rate of consumption which would correspond to 5,000 kilowatt hour per capita. And at that rate of consumption, the coal, which otherwise on today's rate would last 100 years, at that rate it would last only just 11 years. So even if you somehow manage 50 years and preserve all the coal that we have or all the hydrocarbons that we have, it's not going to last much longer from that point onward. Unless, of course, we conclude that we will never reach that stage of development. So in that context, and this is what I said in the beginning, the only two things which are of any, which can provide any comfort is nuclear, or more specifically thorium, as far as the non-renewable energy sources are concerned, and solar energy, as far as the renewable energy sources are concerned. None of the other sources would be of any significant consequences at that point of time. That does not mean that they are not important. They are, of course, important, and today we must make full use of every energy resource that is available to us. But in terms of preparing the country for the future, I think we must keep this picture firmly in our mind. Now, of course, I have said that if we, to collect the entire energy that India would need at that point of time through solar insolation, you require something like 45,000 square kilometers of land area. And of course, there is also a debate whether so much of land area can be diverted or not. And many of you must have read Professor Sukhatme's paper, I think it appeared in Current Science, where in fact he felt that so much of land area cannot be diverted. And so in fact he puts the target at 2000 kilowatt hour per capita and argues that solar energy cannot really contribute the entire requirement. And what will be the actual situation, time only will tell. In fact, it's more a what kind of determination and how the country runs itself, and there are several issues involved, so one can't be sure about it, but arithmetic tells us that this 45,000 square kilometer, if you are able to manage, then you can get the entire energy through solar insolation, and that corresponds to roughly 1/4. In Indian landmass, the area is categorized in different categories. And one of those categories is barren, uncultivable. And I think that's a landmass which certainly can be targeted for this purpose. And 45,000 square kilometer corresponds to 1/4 of the total barren, uncultivable land that we have in our country. Of course, it may be difficult terrain, it may be mostly deserts, it may be mostly barren hills or very undulated uneven land or snow-clad Himalayas and places of that kind. So I think certainly we should keep that in view in terms of deciding the technology development options, because I think if we want solar energy on that large scale, then we must be conscious that we can't find so much of area which on a land which has other uses or which is close to population. And as I'll come later, that actually puts some demands on the technology, and for which we need to carry out some India-specific development. And of course, this, of course, is again a commonplace accepted understanding now that the climate change is here to stay, and we cannot really think in terms of business as usual manner. So even if there is coal, even if there is hydrocarbon, we better change our track, or at least start changing our track right now, so that we don't go anywhere close to the tipping point. I'll come to this in detail in a short while, but what are the challenges? Today, as many of you would be aware, thanks to a great emphasis placed by the government on solar energy, we now have this Jawaharlal Nehru National Solar Mission. Government announced a lot of subsidy regime for that purpose. And the aim was to enhance the penetration of solar energy, enhance the business in solar energy, and so that the costs get driven down just by sheer increase in the size of business, you know, pure commercial logic. And that has actually worked. Consecutive bidding processes which have gone on for solar energy have showed that the prices have got depressed much faster than what was visualized earlier. Of course, there are other factors. For example, Chinese now supply these products much cheaper, and I'll talk about that a little later. But the fact is that government policies in these directions have in fact worked, and today, for example, last couple of biddings have shown that people are now offering solar energy plants at roughly around 8 rupees a kilowatt hour, which is within the striking distance of a competitive tariff, I would say. And certainly 8 rupees is very attractive compared to the cost of merchant power today. Merchant power is being traded at tariffs significantly higher than 8 rupees. So I think there is optimism now that solar energy would become cost competitive sooner than what was visualized earlier. However, if you just depend on purely policy issues, you know, things change, this dynamics changes. It is dependent on how the market players, first of all, how they are acting from their own perspective, business perspectives, but they can also play games and exploit. And so it's important that we must make special efforts in technological terms to drive the costs down. Secondly, all that I told you is essentially in the context of photovoltaics. There is an equivalent kind of complementary component of solar energy, which is solar thermal. And we do not know what would be the cost on a large-scale deployment of solar thermal as of now. But I put it to you that in terms of gaining full indigenous control on technology, solar thermal is more amenable for us to engineer ourselves, for us to build requisite technologies ourselves and do everything completely on our own. Now, of course, clearly solar energy is not nuclear, so those strategic issues and the barriers that we see, you don't really expect in case of solar energy. But that does not mean that this will be entirely free of any barriers. In fact, if you go by the example of rare earths, and I'm going to talk about rare earths in the context of solar energy in a little while. But Chinese have, see, initially they started dumping rare earths. in the meantime, they developed all value-added technologies and value-added products, and then they have suddenly stopped selling raw materials, and so their export tax regime is, in fact, you get the value-added product cheaper and you have to pay huge tax if you want to buy the items at the lower end of the value chain. And that has, in fact, created a huge adverse impact all over the world, including the big powers like United States, Japan, and so on and so forth. So point I'm making is, same thing can happen in the context of silicon, or for that matter, new photovoltaic materials that may come on the horizon tomorrow. Today, Chinese are dumping silicon value-added products, and that's what is, in fact, it's created a huge problem for the Indian manufacturing industry in solar energy. And so much so that some of them are feeling threatened in terms of their very survival. So it is in that context that I think full control of this entire supply chain within the country is of crucial importance, particularly when we are talking about a large program. Solar energy, if it has to supply a very large part of the total Indian electricity needs, we are talking about a fairly large program. And so we cannot afford to just depend on global markets in terms of the supply chain, because we are going to be the larger part of the market, and so we must have. And it is in that sense that I think we need to be able to organize the entire supply chain, both for photovoltaics as well as for solar thermal, right within our country. And I think it's easier relatively to do that in case of solar thermal. And tomorrow, of course, we must catch up in the context of photovoltaics as well. The second important challenge, and of course, I'm going to come to details later on, but in broad terms, I think these are very important. And second important challenge is to be able to address this cost of energy storage. And today, of course, if you have grid-connected power, you just connect to grid, and the grid would take care. It will just become. But this is okay as long as solar energy is a small part, small fraction of the total system, energy system. But once it starts becoming a larger part, and then we'll have to address this question of storage. Even otherwise, you need to address this question in the sense of standalone gadgets, where you need to have a battery, which is a sizable cost of the installation. So whichever way you look at it, one needs to worry about the cost of storage. And there are a whole range of things. It's not just the electrical batteries, but even other modes of energy storage one may have to talk about. Another way of kind of depressing the capital cost or effective capital cost is to work these technologies in hybrid mode. If you work them in hybrid mode, then you can actually supply energy over a longer duration, much longer than the duration over which the sun shines. You could think of a hybrid in terms of photovoltaic and biomass. You can also think in terms of photovoltaic and wind. It depends on the condition which exists. In the long run, I am of the firm view that you can also think of hybrid between photovoltaics and solar thermal. And this is, this of course would be possible only when we get either the photovoltaic materials which can operate at higher temperatures. Higher temperatures which are sufficient for the energy conversion systems through thermal means. So we are talking about 300 degrees Celsius, 500 degrees Celsius, or even higher. This may appear pipe dream today, but I am actually convinced that this would be the ultimate answer. Now, whether it will come through photovoltaic means or whether it will come to thermionic emission means or some other means, I don't know. It depends on how the technology move forward. But I know work is going on in all these areas. I have been, in fact, wherever I talk about it, I have been talking about it almost to the extent of people considering me as a person obsessed with this. But, well, that's what I am. And because, you know, the normal assessment is if you increase the temperature, the efficiency of solar cells comes down. And we're talking about this even when you're talking about temperatures like 80 degrees Celsius or 100 degrees Celsius. So where is the question of talking about 300, 500, that kind of a temperature? But there are materials which can withstand this kind of temperature. But once you do that, and supposing you get even 25-30%, now of course photovoltaic people are talking about 40% efficiency. The remaining part of the energy, since it now we are operating at higher temperature, because it appears at higher temperature, you can again convert that remaining energy back to electricity through a thermodynamic cycle with an efficiency of maybe 40%, 50%. And overall, you can easily clock efficiencies of the order of 60% plus. Now, this I think is eminently possible, and once that happens, you'll find, provided you are able to do this with some cost control, the effective capital cost would get significantly depressed. There are, of course, other methods like concentration and all, which will also allow you to depress the capital cost. Another important thing that we need to worry about it is many of these areas, which the so-called barren, uncultivable land areas, they are also likely to be the areas where water supply is not likely to be available. They will be all arid areas. And so you must think about systems where dependence on water is either not there or is at a minimum level. And that should be another driver for technologies for solar conversion. So like that, we have to take several technology initiatives. Now, today, what is the scene in the country in terms of the, of course, I know that around the country, I think practically every institution, there is some work on solar energy going, because it is a very popular topic, it is current topic, people are interested in this. And of course, there is funding available. So there is some work or the other going on everywhere. So this is the good news, I think. However, if you ask that how much of it is something which can be translated into a robust field deployable technology in next 6 months or next 1 year, I think the picture is very dismal. It is you don't have confidence of that kind of thing being done. My own colleagues, because I talked to them that, look, we talked about 20 megawatt system in the year 1989-1990. So today we should be talking about, I'm talking about solar thermal, 100 megawatt system or beyond. But even today, I think the reach is not going beyond maybe why not we try at 100 kilowatt level or 500 kilowatt level? And this actually I don't understand. I think we know enough to leapfrog. Now what do we need to do is to be able to sort of create a consortium of people who can contribute their bit in different areas, including industries who can convert those developments or those ideas into robust products. And then luckily we have MNRE has one research center already in near Delhi, which is operating for a long time. And there are a lot of inputs pumped in into that research center. But more importantly, at IIT Jodhpur, there is a separate 200-acre plot exclusively dedicated to solar energy. And I think that's a very important kind of situation in the context of demonstrating very robust technologies. And the presence of IIT Jodhpur, although it's a new institution, it will take some time for them to get some hands-on confidence on dealing with technology on a large scale. But the fact is, that's where there are thinkers, good academics, and more, even more important, that's where there are students. And so, I think, and Dr. Ramamurthy is a part and parcel of this process, I think we can create a kind of a consortium where everybody who can contribute can be brought together, and then create another framework for implementing projects on a somewhat larger scale. At this moment, I'm targeting something like 5 megawatts demonstration plants of 3 different varieties, so that we can see from there on. And if you can do that in, let's say, next 2 or 3 years, then one can be ready to decide whether can we now go to 100 megawatt or hundreds of megawatt scale from that time onwards. So I have not put any details on that because this is all under debate. But that's the direction which we should perhaps pursue. Now, with this, let me quickly run through a number of bullet points, as it were, just to sort of take stock of different points. So it's a kind of a laundry list, and there may be a few points missing, but you'll get a flavor of what kind of thing we need to do. Now, in terms of solar collection area, as I said earlier, we need to talk about collection area which is free from any kind of land use conflict. Because solar energy is, it's a diffused energy. Necessarily, it's going to require large area, and you know what happens whenever we're talking about large land areas for any project. And so I think we need to be completely away from those conflicts and so concentrate on areas which may have a lot of difficulties, logistic difficulties, creating projects in an area where people cannot go easily, people cannot live easily, is not very easy. But I think that's the direction we should go. Of course, rooftops is a good idea, and certainly, wherever there are roofs, obviously there are loads, electrical loads, so it makes sense to use all that. But other than that, I think we should really focus on barren, uncultivable lands which are away from population. As I said, this means deserts, this means barren hills, snowy mountains with a lot of snow on them. And so there could be issues, particularly in deserts, of huge amount of dust load. I have seen a panel, if you keep it open, I think within 2 days, if you see from outside, that panel starts looking brown. So much of dust load. And I was quite glad that IIT Jodhpur, some of the early experiments are in fact in terms of looking at the wind flow patterns around a solar field and how the dust kind of accumulates and moves on those panels, and a lot of things are being studied there. some places in the deserts, the sand actually moves, it gets lifted from, you know, the sand dunes move, which in turn moves, so that the sand moves at sufficiently, you know, it gets lifted from the ground, moves. And so you have an atmosphere of what in the engineering language we call sandblasting. And sandblasting is a method of cleaning surfaces, you know, all the scales you remove. So it is that abrasive. And so the question is whether all these things will survive in that kind of a thing. What kind of surfaces you need to create which can survive without creating adverse impact on the optical properties, because after all, you need to either absorb light or reflect light with very high efficiency, and that should not get affected. Non-availability of water, so we should be able to clean with minimum water, and also we should be able to go through energy conversion with minimum water. And of course, it goes without saying that it should be relatively maintenance-free operation. Talking about reduction in capital costs, of course, the policy initiatives have done a lot. There is, for a standalone system, there is a capital subsidy. For grid-connected systems, there is tariff subsidy now. On top of it, the other electricity generators, they have this statutory renewable energy purchase obligations. So they have to invest or buy or produce that much of electricity. And also for people who produce renewable energy, there are these renewable energy certificates by which you can trade them. And there will be time where you can trade them at great premium, just like merchant power you can actually trade. And then, of course, the competitive bidding. So this actually has, as I said earlier, substantially suppressed the capital cost. Chinese phenomena I did mention. There is also an American phenomena. Apparently, there are a lot of this international funding for renewable energy, particularly solar energy, with extremely low interest rates. But the condition is you have to buy their products. And that creates again the Indian manufacturers. I think Indian manufacturers are under dual attack. And we do need some kind of a dynamic policy management regime to make sure that Indian industry survives, and not only survives, but in fact flourishes and grows. I did talk about the hybrids and the energy storage systems, not just electrical, but thermal, which are, I think, likely to be fairly cost competitive. And that's what will give solar thermal that much extra advantage, because you can easily store that energy at a much cheaper price. There are also this mechanical storage. I have put this word mechanical because you can either pump water, or there are also possibilities in future of batteries which are based on the kinetic energy, the spinning disks, which in fact it has been shown that they can store energy at a power density or energy density much higher than what can be done using electrical storage methods. And there have been some trials, but again, it's a very difficult technology, but someday it could be realized. Having said that, there are of course the other things which straight away come to mind, and I'm not going to spend time on that, but the questions of the photovoltaic cells themselves are undergoing a lot of development, both for reducing costs, increasing the efficiency, and as I said, the high temperature capability. LEDs are an important area. If you're talking about light, then LED and solar energy, I think it's a great combination. And you have now lights which are just say 2 watts and which are sufficient to sort of illuminate your study table and do your study. And you can sell these lights even without any subsidy at just a few hundred rupees. So there is this paradigm change, but the fact is we don't have a huge production capacity on LEDs in the country. Same thing about batteries, tracking and control. These are all important cost elements in this. High performance reflectors, absorber surfaces, glass to metal seals, you know, for the parabolite, linear parabolite or linear Fresnel, if you are putting it in evacuated tube, glass to metal seals is one of the very important cost element, and there are only a couple of companies in the world who supply this. But this is a technology which we can easily manage in the country. And finally, the engineering itself, the value engineering, the low cost engineering. And this is, of course, textbook stuff. The efficiencies are growing. I put this essentially to, there is always this issue. If you want to invest in photovoltaics, let's say, what do we invest in? There is always this question that silicon is a, whether it's a thing of today, tomorrow, or it's already a thing of yesterday. There are a lot of new things coming, and when you want to make investment decisions in the country, it should not so happen that you invest in something which within a couple of years becomes obsolete. And this actually is going to be an ongoing issue for us to be able to deal with as to what is the correct business decision in terms of investment, looking at a very rapid change in technologies of these materials. But having so, at this moment it looks like that silicon is here to stay for at least 10-15 years or more. But we need to get a handle on this kind of technology foresight to be able to do right decisions. And then of course the issue of the entire supply chain within the country. You would notice in that, apart from silicon, PV materials, LEDs, I have also added rare earth and magnets. And I have done this intentionally because in the context of agricultural pumping, which I'll talk later, this would come in. But at this point of time, the only point I wish to stress is I think we have technological capability in rare earths, but we don't have a sizable manufacturing capacity, not even in rare earths, and even lower in terms of the value-added rare earth products. Of course, for the strategic program, for centrifuge program, and all those rare earth magnets are being produced in the country. But we are talking about a much larger scale, an order of magnitude larger scale. Then we'll have to address a different animal altogether, and we need to be conscious about it. Now, I'm not going to describe all elements of solar energy. Means different things to different people, and so I thought I just put them in 4 quadrants. On one side, a division based on whether it's connected to grid or not connected to the grid. On the other side, a division based on whether we're talking about photovoltaics or solar thermal. And all of them have their niche area. I'm going to only focus on 2 things. One, technologies that we need to kind of develop quickly, where we can put very large capacity power plants. And today it's already happening with photovoltaic, because not that we have control on the technology, but the global business is such that through policy regime we have made, I think, good progress. But tomorrow we have to catch on the technology part. But I would say in terms of technology. First, I think we have to give a much larger drive in terms of the laboratory work to come up with the Indian solutions which can be productized later in photovoltaic area. But till that time, I think the deployment will go on the basis of what's available in the market, which is not a bad thing. However, on the solar thermal, the picture is entirely different, and there, unless, of course, there again plants at the scale of a megawatt or little higher are being set up, a number of plants have come up. But these are all what I call vendor-driven technologies. So the complete plant has been configured by somebody, and it has been set up. And such plants have been set up even 20, 30 years ago, only to find that it did not work. I'm not saying that it's important that we have some hands-on feel of these kind of facilities for two reasons. One, whatever capacity we set up, we should be able to run it well. But more importantly, we should be able to grow. We should be able to build bigger plants on that capability. And this, I think, is well within our reach. And so at this moment, I'm giving a lot of emphasis on developing capability to build large capacity solar thermal plants on the basis of indigenous technology, while the photovoltaic route is already making its headway. The second element that we should stress is in terms of the electricity supply to villages, the so-called microgrid issue. Now, there is a lot of programs in terms of the so-called Gramin Vidyutikaran Yojana or the rural light schemes. Now, much of that is a part of the Ministry of Power. And now I think there is, of course, there is a lot of coordination between MNRE and Ministry of Power. But some of it, I think, could also be handled by MNRE in terms of solar energy. And that's another area that we should emphasize. Connected with that is also this aspect of agricultural pumping, and I'll come to that, and the rural light. But I have put this picture only to say that that's not all about solar energy. There are several things connected with that, but I'm not going to talk about all those. Now, with this, let me come to two or three very specific, almost missions that we should do in solar energy. The first one is about the standalone solar powered pumps. Today, we know that our health of electricity boards is very strongly dependent on whether they are able to recover the price or the cost of electricity which goes to agricultural pumping. In fact, they don't recover anything, more or less. The result of that is they have to charge that much extra for the industrial consumers. So it's a kind of a cross subsidy. The industrial consumer subsidizes for the agricultural energy use. Now, that in turn makes the energy cost into our industrial production high, creating issues about their competitiveness. So imagine that you make a transition where you say that entire agricultural pumping is reserved for standalone power sources, and in the context of among the standalone power sources, solar power perhaps would, in fact, of course you could do also diesel, but then there are question of diesel subsidy, as question of use of hydrocarbons, so on. So solar power is, according to me, an ideal solution for standalone pumping. So what if government gives these installations at very attractive, I'm not saying free, but near free way these things are distributed? Only condition is you have to disconnect from the grid supply. If you do that, and if you are able to take off a good part of agricultural pumping without any detriment to the requirement of agricultural pumping, I think the health of our electricity boards will improve. And if that happens, the health of our industries will improve because there will be cheaper electricity. And if that happens, I think it will give that much added boost to the economic growth in the country. And so I feel that this is a well worth effort. This is number one. Number two is, once we start moving in that direction, we should also think about making this pumping more efficient. And of course, in past also several efforts have been done in terms of more efficient pumps, so that we don't lose energy, choice of materials, choice of design, and so on and so forth. But one important initiative could be to resort to DC motor driven pumps rather than AC motor driven pumps. Today it may appear that these motors would be more expensive compared to AC motors, but once the production scales come in, I see no reason why those motors cannot be also at the same cost or cheaper for that matter. But I think this is what the whole national system has to be driven to achieve this. If you are able to do that, then two things will happen. One is the cost of inverter gets eliminated, because from the panel you produce DC and feed it into the pump. So there is a saving on that. And also the motor itself could be a little more efficient compared to the AC motor, because these are all, after all, small motors. They are not large, high capacity motors. But the quantities involved in this would be much larger. In the other high-tech application, the quantities are smaller. And of course, the key challenge is the ability to do so at a low cost. Now, in India, the rare earth source is monazite. And some time back, as you are aware, in atomic energy, we were suffering this uranium crisis. And at that time, we in fact resorted to recovering even uranium from monazite, which nobody does. But monazite is actually a mineral for thorium. But it has some quantity of, so in fact, we